As the Netherlands, we have a small time slot at the beginning of those 2 days to present ourselves, to present our poldering, to present our best practices. And I really like to start with a small film, small movie, with a few of our stakeholders in it, just to get you to warm up and be awake for the next slots. So,
welcome to the Netherlands. In the Netherlands, we do the strangest things. We get our snacks out of a wall. We have more bites than people. And for breakfast, we put chocolate on our sandwiches. We all wear orange to watch our national football team play or celebrate the king's birthday together. Did you also know that the world's number one DJs are Dutch? And that our tulips at Keukenhof are visited by more than 1 million people every year? That we can make land out of water and have amazing clouds that inspired many famous painters? You may already be familiar with our distinctive culture, but did you also know that the Netherlands was the first European country connected to the public internet service? That was made possible by CWI, the Institute for Mathematics and Computer Science in the Netherlands, and that it currently hosts the world-leading internet exchange point. With its stable infrastructure for fixed and mobile communication, the Netherlands has been one of the world leaders for many years. Nevertheless, we face the challenge of safeguarding several values simultaneously: freedom, security, openness, and stability. These values can be at odds with each other. The Dutch answer to these questions is in our DNA, in our history, in our future. We call it polderen, or finding common ground. Auke Pauls is head of the ECP Young Digital Advisory Board. He advises the government and companies and argues for a free internet.
Free internet is really important for young people because free internet enables them to develop themselves, also to communicate with others with the same or other interests, and to explore their world, their vision on other things. Benefits of a free internet are that people can express themselves and do have the right of information.
A free internet has many advantages, but also a dark side, like cybercrime and child pornography. How do we keep a free internet network secure? Arda Gerkens is head of the online expertise center Child Abuse. She deals with this question on a daily basis.
We work with child abuse material, so we're trying to take it down from the internet. And we do this with a voluntary code. I think that's really special for the Netherlands, because I know in many other countries this is set up in legislation. So we see the far majority of the internet hosting providers are helpful and willing because, you know, just like in society, the majority doesn't want this material to be out there. However, we do have some bad hosters. And now we feel that we have come to all the possibilities we can do without legislation to get the material down. And we're now looking at different forms of legislation to see how we can do more to still be able to tackle the problem with the bad hosters without getting really severe legislation out there, which would then diminish the freedom of speech. But to be able to get to the minimum of legislation needed, you need to work together and to collaborate and talk to each other.
How do we protect our freedom of speech in an open internet without limiting our democracy with overregulation, whilst ensuring that big tech companies don't get access to all our data? Evelyn Austin is a movement builder at Bits of Freedom. And this question is at the core of her mission.
So what we see is that a few big companies dominate our media and communications landscape. And because of that, they wield incredible power over our public debate and over the core of our democracy. So Europe needs to start reigning in big tech. We need to reclaim our society's data, and we need to start protecting human rights. We need to start stimulating European tech that's grounded in public values, and we have to start passing regulation that addresses more than just the symptoms of these problems.
The digital age has to tackle multiple core online values, like openness, security, and freedom. Equally, if not more important, is to keep the internet stable, because stability provides trust, growth, and innovation. SIDN is the organization that manages the .nl domain, one of the world's most secure and stable domains. Their CEO, Roelof Meijer, explains why a stable internet is so important.
The Netherlands are in the global top ranks with regard to broadband penetration, internet use, internet speed, e-commerce, and quite a few others. And this means that we've become hugely dependent on an always accessible, everywhere available and very stable internet. We have that here, but that's not an easy thing to accomplish. Most of all, it requires intensive collaboration and shared responsibilities between the public sector, the private sector and civil society. Inclusive internet governance is a critical success factor, and this is why the European Dialogue on Internet Governance and the Global Dialogue on Internet Governance are so important. After all, the internet is borderless and we can't just focus on our own country.
The Netherlands might strike you as a peculiar country with a distinctive culture, but through our typical perseverance and belief in collaboration with all stakeholders, we can help create a better future.
I like to challenge you and do it the Dutch way. Listen to each other, talk to each other, debate and look for common ground. This is your chance to contribute to the discussion on the future of the internet here in The Hague.
Welcome to EuroDig 2019.
Welcome in the Netherlands. I'm very happy to hand over the microphone to my boss, my director, Arie van Bellen, who has multi-stakeholder cooperation in his veins. From the very beginning of digital society, he works together with everybody, with all public-private partnerships creating every day. So I'm very, very happy that you're here and moderate the next session.
Thank you very much, Marjolein. Let me get up here and get this. Well, good morning, everybody. More and more people getting through the rain. I will try to make you a little bit warm, giving you a short insight in this bouldering. How do we do that? How does it work? And not to have an example that you all have to follow, but because it is a little bit peculiar. It is Dutch, but it works. And maybe elements in the method of public-private partnership can be useful for you in your work. What we're doing now in a little block is two good examples in practice how we work together, business, government and civil society. But first of all, let me explain a little bit shortly this picture and also my organization. ECP is established already 20 years ago and it is really also only in function to be an oil man between the different stakeholders to get the Netherlands further in a successful and trusted digital society and economy. And the first learning point for us was that we needed six stakeholders to be together. And we achieved to bring them together. That is, business community at the tech side, but also business community at the user side. Government, but in two capacities. A huge user of technology, and the government to safeguard the guidelines, the rules, the values. Then you need intermediary organizations, like the consumer organization, the employer organization. This development is not only a revolution, it's an evolution. So existing powerful stakeholders have to be taken along, and we put them into our processes. And of course, science. Science is a very important partner in developing digital Netherlands and our digital world. Last but not least, and in the film you saw Auke, our chairman of our youth council, you have to involve civil society. It's not PPS, public-private partnership, it's PPPS, public-private people partnership. Civil society, like youth, like elderly, like patients, and we involve them, all of them. But how can you make such processes successful? First of all, you have to make a set of rules about the processes. The openness, but also the trust that you put there in those processes. We work closely with government, and there is real leadership, you will hear later, in our cabinet, in our government, on the digital agenda. But our processes are not in the government, but together with the government. to be open in how we make solutions for partnerships, like we did on child pornography, on detecting botnets, on all other topics. And we have a peculiar process management. Of course, the Dutch way, when we have a meeting and we want to make a building block, an agreement on a topic in the digital age, well, an afternoon discussion always starts with sandwiches, the Dutch way. That's only a little bread with cheese and milk. We had some Belgian guests and they were amazed. Later on in the afternoon, you get particular cookies with the tea, stroopwafels. You should taste them when you're over here. And then in the end, if you had a good meeting, you get maybe water, a little beer with bitterballs. And then you hope you have achieved something that sticks. And our strategy in that is that sometimes we look at particular technologies. How can the Netherlands be still involved in the big artificial intelligence development? Do we have a position as the Netherlands? What parts of that development are we good in or not? So technology is a focus point, but only together with domains. In which parts of our lives do those disrupting technologies really make changes? Like healthcare, like climate, like retail, finance. So sometimes we have activities that look into a domain, but always together with a disruptive technology input. And the third and last is, what kind of guidelines, rules do we have, and which ones are not capable to cope with this development? It's not only the legal framework, it's also the security framework, the ethical framework, the political framework. And with this vision, we're working very hard. I have 130 members, and we have huge programs. And we're paid by all the stakeholders together. So we're not depending on one of them. We're not part of government. We're not part of business. We're no consultancy. We're not a branch organization. It's a meeting of the minds, and it works. We have a lot of alliances in place. I won't get into those. I want now to introduce two examples of partners of ours, influential people, influential projects that really work along with this public-private partnership. I go to the first one, and two people will now come forward, a lady and a gentleman. First of all, you're nearest to the stairs. No, you are. Larissa Zegveld. She is chairperson of our Forum of Standardization. And next comes Gerben Klein-Balting. He is the chairman of our internet standards platform in the Netherlands. Give them a warm hand. I will hand over to you. And their topic and their program is internet.nl. Go ahead.
Thank you, Ali. Well, Larissa and I will talk about something really boring. So I hope you are still awake at the end of our presentation. What we will discuss is the importance of standards. And standards are those sometimes tiny lines of code in between you and the basics of the internet. And what we thought of almost 5 years ago was that we saw a lack in the adoption of those standards. It was not going fast enough. So what we tried to do is promote those modern, secure internet standards. And it does relate to governance, to control over the internet, to the usability. And how do we do that? That's what I will explain, and later on, Larissa will focus on the way the government deals with standards in the Netherlands. Behind me, you see the partners in what we call the Internet Standards Platform. It is an PPS or PPPS construction where we try to bring together Dutch government and the most important players in the field of the internet infrastructure, the basic things. But we try to keep the end user, either government, an organization, a business, or an individual person, in mind. Because what we think, what we believe, is that in the end, everybody should have access. And therefore, we have this typical Dutch tile. We call it tegeltjeswijsheid, or tile wisdom. You find them in many houses in the Netherlands with very intriguing text. But this is our motto, the open, free and secure internet. That is really the reason why we work together in the Internet Standards Platform. And we do that, as I showed, with a lot of parties that focus currently on these modern standards. I'm not going to explain them all to you, but I hope that many of you at least have heard about these standards. We try to select those standards that are already there, so you can implement them, that have effective use to keep the internet open, free and secure. So it's all about connectivity, protecting your data, your privacy, making sure that you go to the right website, that there is not a man in the middle, but that you actually go to the website you want to visit, and that when you send an email, that you can really trust the emails you receive and the emails you send out. Those standards may seem a little bit complicated, and sometimes they are. We have to be very honest about that. So I'm not going to say that's a piece of cake to introduce these modern standards in your own organization. But from the beginning, we have tried to help you. We want to share knowledge. We want to enable you to have a platform where you can talk to, so people are invited to join us and discuss with us the reasoning behind these standards. But you can also easily see yourself when you look at internet.nl, a website devised almost 4 years ago. At that website, you can actually see if your own organization, web-based, email sending, and the local connection you use is up to speed with those modern internet standards. And I will show you some results, because the internet test is something, but we did it for you, at least for around 200 of you that were sharing their data with us and said it's okay to test them. Anonymously, of course, initially, and here you see the aggregate results. The results of around 200 participants in this conference. If we look at the standards, you see that IPv6 adoption, it's a little bit low. I'm a bit disappointed. The same goes, and that might be even worse, from a security point of view, DNSSEC, the security extension to what we do in the domain name system. HTTPS, that sounds promising, 92%, that's great. But then if you look at the policy, how do you configure your settings, then it's not that good. But luckily enough, there are some organizations present today that do it better than average, much better than average. And we even have what we call a winner. So I'll come back to that in a few seconds. But be prepared that I will ask one of you to come forward. If we look at the modern email security standards, the other ones were the web standards, then you see the following results. Many of you already implement DKIM and SPF, and even with a strict policy on SPF, which is good. For DMARC, the 36% is promising as well, but the DMARC policy is falling behind with only 13%. Start TLS is there, that's good. So you have secure connections, that's great. The configuration is starting to pick up with 56%, but DNSSEC over your mail server, and especially DANE, are low. So what I would like to invite all of you to do is check your own organization versus these standards. It's a simple test. It will take you a few seconds, and you have a lot of explanation behind it. If we have time, we will even do a live test in a few minutes. But the winner is the Swedish Post and Telecom Authority, PTS.se. And is there somebody present?
Are they in the room?
We have a small present for you. So if somebody from PTS.se is in the room, no.
Or too shy, maybe?
Too shy.
We will keep the present. We will pick them
up. We will keep the present and make sure that you receive it later on. But to give you the idea, their web security score was 97% and their email security score was 100%. So that's a really big applause for the Swedish Post and Telecom Authority. Thank you. And I'll hand over to Larissa.
Yeah. Thank you, Gerben. Well, the results we get here speak volumes and show that we have work to do. But first of all, allow me to introduce myself. I'm Larissa Zegveld. I'm delighted to be with you here today. And I stand here on behalf of the Dutch Standardization Forum. Oh, sorry. While I also lead the corporation, the Dutch corporation, We Go For It. And We Go For It provides IT services in the social domain to the people of the four large Dutch municipalities. And what we see is that public services nowadays are often provided digitally. People use the internet to search for and manage services they need, like social security payments. And therefore, it's very important the government provides secure traffic on the internet, while also ensuring high levels of accessibility. To enable people with different skill sets from different backgrounds to make use of the services they are entitled to. And this is where the Dutch Standardization Forum comes in. First of all, in supporting the Dutch government in the development and use of open standards for electronic information exchange with citizens. The second goal of the Standardization Forum is to prevent vendor lock-in and to reduce costs in the public spending on ICT. For those who aren't familiar with the term vendor lock-in, a vendor lock-in makes a customer dependent on a vendor for product and services, enabled to use another vendor without substantial switching costs. To provide public services to civilians, organizations are required to work together because their individual services are part of a larger chain. Therefore, it's very important that everybody in that chain keeps up the same standards. The Standardization Forum advises the Dutch government on such matters. The open standards Gerben just showed us all apply to the public institutions and enable a good flow of information between these institutions, while at the same time IT services are kept secure. We keep a list of all these standards and monitor how public organizations comply. Our policy is to promote working with open standards, to make it a norm. This is because we know the open standards contribute to a better information exchange between institutions and decrease the chance of a vendor lock-in. Together, we select the standards we need to comply with. If an organization does not comply, it needs to explain why it doesn't. The Forum of Standardization monitors their compliance. In short, we call this policy comply or explain. So how does that work in practice? First, an organization might call for a tender. In the tender request, it includes our list of open standards. If the chosen vendor doesn't deliver these open standards, the organization will have to explain why it still does choose to work with that vendor. So our list of standards acts as a tool for public institutions to do better tenders with IT companies. The institution can trust that if they are compliant with the open standards, they deliver safe services and that's ensured. By working with open standards, we also decrease the chance of vendor lock-in. And this is very important because a vendor lock-in makes that public organizations can't switch very easily to a new supplier. The transition would hurt their services to people too much for too long. Our standards and open standards help us to avoid this problem while ensuring safe services. So apply the standards or explain why you don't. People sometimes ask me, why don't we advocate for law that allows to fine non-compliant organizations? Well, I don't believe in adding such a bureaucratic layer. The fact is, I've never met a single colleague in my entire career who desired to provide unsafe services. Nobody wants to provide unsafe services. And in the rare instance this would be the case, such a person would simply need to be fired and replaced. That's a joke. It's much more, in my opinion, about helping everyone to comply with the standards in a good way or fashion. There's no generic way for every organization in applying for open standards. While the Forum of Standardization distributes and manages the list of open standards, next to monitoring for compliance, we also promote sharing knowledge and experience between organizations. For example, when test results show one organization scores much higher on their compliance than another organization, we advise them to have a look at the well-performing institution to see how they have managed to achieve such a high score and subsequently try to apply the lessons learned. So, sum up. By using the policy Comply or Explain, managing an up-to-date list of open standards, pushing for inter-organizational exchange of knowledge while also monitoring and measuring, digital services for people become safe and better accessible. Important to note is that we make use of exactly the same internet.nl tool Gerben just presented. The tool is for free and it's very easy to use. And I would like to invite you all to use it for the benefit of your organization security and the customers you provide services for. And now our votes, results, I mean. These are the results of the Netherlands, the Dutch public organizations in the Netherlands. You're looking at how compliant the 500 biggest public organizations in the Netherlands are. They're complying quite well. But we know the smaller organizations, which are not included in this particular data set, are not that compliant. They would be helped by having agreements on a national or perhaps even an international level. And one of the future plans of the Standardization Forum is to play a constructive role here as well. Already, we're discussing making arrangements with the larger private vendors to get them to always comply with the list of open standards. In this way, both the large and the smaller organizations don't have to make their own arrangements with the vendors. Using the right standards will become the norm for these vendors. Regarding these results, all in all, the latest level of compliance is encouraging, and certainly not bad. But at the same time, we are aware our job is never done. New security threats emerge on a regular basis. We simply can never achieve 100% safety. On a final note, I would like to address to you directly, dear audience. In inviting to work together as public, private and other organizations, make use of a tool like Gerben just presented. Discuss with fellow organizations that are outperforming you how they manage to reach their level of use of open standards. By doing this, we create better and more safe services for your customers, our customers and civilians. I wish you the best in this endeavor and hope you enjoy your time on Juridic. Thank you.
We still have room, I guess, for one or two tests.
Just a little bit time, yeah.
And there might be even a small present for the one who is daring to enter his or her organization in the website test. Anybody? Is there a volunteer? Hard to see from here, but...
Otherwise, we just pick one.
Yeah.
Oh, daar gaat een...
We have a volunteer?
We have a... No?
Yeah, this gentleman? Or were you just waving? Can you come forward?
Oh, over there, a gentleman. Yeah.
Ah.
Please come forward, please.
Oh. I'm now addressing this gentleman, or who's first? We can only take one. I'll take this gentleman. Yes, you should. Hi, who are you?
Nigel.
Nigel, nice to meet you. What's your organization?
ICANN.
Oh, because ICANN has its standards in place. I'm very anxious to know. Go ahead.
This could be career limiting.
Yes. No, we make sure that won't happen. Hi, Larissa. Hi. Well, tough choice. Yeah.
Well,
let's see. Yeah. An applause.
Good to see and congratulations. I mean, 94% is not a really bad score. There is something wrong, perhaps, with your HTTPS. Let's scroll down and see what's happening
there.
Oh,
something wrong with the HTTPS.
Your redirection settings are perhaps not quite okay. But that seems to be the only thing right here in the web thing. But I will check your email as well. Let's have a look. Hey, 84%. It's not too bad at all.
And we should have DNSSEC, I think. You know. So.
But I see that you do miss something like DMARC policy. So you have DMARC on your email server, but there is not a real strict policy enforced. So it's like a sticker on your front door telling them that there is a lock, but there is actually no lock.
Sorry.
Anyhow, I think you're brave enough to come forward. ICANN is a really important organization in our internet infrastructure, and the scores are more than average. So I will give you a small present for ICANN.
Thank you.
Enjoy.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
No, thank you.
Thank you very much, Nigel. All right, guys, thank you very much.
Yes,
and
perfect.
Other people can all try it, can use it.
Yes,
and
it's
I
for
see
free.
There is a little table upstairs. If you have questions or more, you are available.
Yep.
We will be there.
You will be here the entire conference. Give them a big hand, Larissa and Gerben.
Yes.
Thank you.
We go to a second keynote on public-private partnership. And now we're looking into the Netherlands as gateway to Europe. If you look at our infrastructure, who will be the guy that's explaining that position of the Netherlands? It is Michiel Steltman, director of the Dutch Infrastructure Organization, DINL. Michiel, give him a hand. Welcome. Go ahead.
Thank you. Welcome and good morning. It's an honor and a pleasure to represent the Dutch digital infrastructure sector consisting of data centers, internet exchanges, domain registrars, cloud companies, hosting companies, a very rich spectrum of companies that built the foundation of the Netherlands internet. And why did we create this association and why do we exist? Well, the Netherlands is very proud to be currently the number one data hub in Europe. We surpassed the major other hubs, Frankfurt, Paris and London yesterday because of a consistent growth of 18 to 20% annually in megawatts in square meters, but also in the growth of hyperscalers, network capacity, and many other factors that create a very strong Dutch position for the internet. And that attracts a lot of economic activity, and this is why the Netherlands has a very strong position now also in many technologies that are created as services here in the Netherlands and are delivered as services to the Netherlands and to many European countries and the rest of the world. So that's a good position to be, but also with that great position as a small country comes great responsibilities in keeping that stable and making sure the freedom of the internet, the stability of the services are preserved, are being managed well. So what we see is also cloud adoption, which is very remarkable. Because in many countries, the term cloud is still confined to, let's say, the hyperscalers, the big companies, the Googles of these worlds. But in the Netherlands, clouds means literally thousands to tens of thousands of companies who've put their services online, keep the data of their businesses that they serve and consumers online and deliver those services. So cloud adoption is very high, and that's a very strong indicator of how economic ecosystems work and what the issues around data, preserving data, protecting data, using data up to AI are meaning. And because of that, we have a multitude, a richness of stakeholders debating and discussing those issues in a relatively small country. If you look at that, we studied that phenomena. How do these ecosystems really work? Already in 2013, with the help of Deloitte, who published our first report, and that was called the third mainport. We used the term mainport, which is not an English word. We only use it exclusively in the Netherlands to indicate major economic hubs. But we found that contrary to, let's say, beliefs that the internet is a technical facility to deliver data, it is also an economic engine. It creates more or less, let's say, a sim city kind of world of all sorts of phenomena that go around the digital infrastructure. We found a very strong a correlation statistically, but also a very strong causal relation between three dominant factors, being on one hand digital infrastructure, you know, the neutral generic facilities that are used to deliver data and technology and that used to bring technology to consumers and businesses on one hand. And the other hand, it stimulates economic growth, economic, let's say, new digital services and service development, but also it impacts society. Because the fact that the Netherlands society is so well connected and all our citizens have easy access to mobile, fixed internet in different forms, indoor, Wi-Fi, on all places, and that's a very rich and well structured and facilitated phenomena. So that means that citizens and companies can access the internet, digital infrastructure makes that happen, digital use is stimulated, and that stimulates, let's say, a snowball effect of a digital economy and many services. And that created, those reports draw some attention also in our parliament, because traditionally, you know the complaints about 10 years ago, well, the politicians and governments do not really understand the internet. They look at internet as a form of IT. We also use the term convergence, that media and internet were sort of converging into something new. But we found really the idea of an economic ecosystem in that mainport got some attention of politics. And in 2015, 2014 was a motion of one of our parties who nominated our digital infrastructure as our third mainport. Or fourth, with another mainport in Eindhoven. There are a little bit of battling over that, but never mind. we had that mainport, and it's been officially recognized as an economic engine, economic motor for future economic growth in the Netherlands. And also because of that, we decided to work together, and also to work together with different governments. In 2015, the Central Bureau of Statistics investigated this mainport phenomena and looked at the internet from a different perspective, which was at that time technology, media, and telecom. We said, well, look at that from a different perspective, a layered, structured world of infrastructure, services, and societal use. And they found that the digital mainport in economic value already surpassed that of Schiphol Airport and our Rotterdam Harbor, which are major economic hubs for Europe. In terms of growth, in terms of number of employees, but also in terms of contribution to the economy. And that's still, of course, a very difficult topic to understand. And we understand the struggle of society and government very much how to deal with that. Because how can a virtual economy have such a strong position if you compare that to a physical economy of something you can touch? Railways, harbors. Still another report of the Dutch Institute that monitors the investments and the progress of the physical infrastructure came to the safe conclusions that investments in digital infrastructure have far better return on investment in economic sense than investments now in some of the physical infrastructures, which is odd if you think about it, and it's still something that all of us need to come to grips to, what that really means and how that's going to develop in the future. Also, our Central Bureau of Statistics made a new model for how to measure the economic value of the digital world. And I think this was a breakthrough approach for measuring that value. And it's very good that they had, let's say, that they were brave enough to use that compared to the traditional way in which economic values of technology are measured. And they said, well, you have what we call the core of the internet economy. And they defined that as companies who exclusively make their money and their earnings of digital activities, not just ICT, but because of the internet, meaning digital shops, digital business models, e-commerce, and many others, where companies exclusively earn their money because the internet exists. That's a new way of looking at that economic value. And they found that core internet economy is already good for about 6 to 9% of our national product. And if you look at that, it places that sector, if you look at that as a sector, in the middle tier. It's even bigger than agriculture, and it's bigger than finance and construction. It's a sector in its own right that has a major contribution to a Dutch economy. Well, with those conclusions, we found that slightly also the way we look at the internet, not just technology and, let's say, externalities, the effects of what we do with that technology, such as cybercrime or threats to our society or geopolitics and many other factors that we're discussing in the IGF and Eurodic and discussing, but also a very important, the economic value, not just the freedom and the openness, but the fact that as a nation or a country, you can actually earn a decent living and you can create a lot of economic value for yourselves, for an economy based on this way of thinking. And that gives some extra ground on the freedom of the openness of the internet. Not just the crucially importance of human rights, the freedom of speech, the openness to develop, and the freedom to place your content online, but also the economic value for our future generations. Our children will make, will have a living, not because the internet disrupts what we have always done, but because the internet is a new factor that gives us our future wealth, which is a key factor also to take into account. And this is why we joined forces. Then the traditional, and those of you who have been in the internet community know how difficult it is to join forces in some of these communities. And we found ourselves on these themes, in the Mainport theme, in the economic cooperation, and keeping and protecting the internet. So the hosting community, the Dutch Data Center Association, the Netherlands ICT organization, and a very close cooperation with SIDN as the guardian of the .nl domain, with the ECP, who's organizing large part of today, and of course with some other organizations that are so, let's say, so elementary and crucial for this economic function and growth, such as the Dutch Startup Association. And we found basically there's a couple of things I'm going to dive a little bit more in detail. We found 8 key factors for that growth. What are those factors? What really constitutes that economic function of the digital mainport, and what factors are crucial for that success, and what factors do we need to keep healthy? I won't explain them all to you. I will just pick out a few details to illustrate what we're talking about. And very often, people ask me, 8, that's a long list. If you have to pick one or two that are the most important, and which one do we really need to focus on to make it happen, and which one are less important? Now, my answer is basically to refer to Liebig's law. And those of you who have a background in biology, maybe some of you have or have some association with that. Liebig's law really says that the total yield is determined by the smallest growth factor. It's by saying you have a plant which needs soil and fertilizer and water and sunlight, you can say, which is the most important? Well, let's focus on the sunlight. And the water we do later on, you will understand that the plant will not survive. Which means that all of these 8 factors have to be addressed. And that's a big task, it's a big job. And it's also our common responsibility to deal with all of these factors. The skills that we need to talk about. Keeping the permissionless innovation, the openness of the internet to innovate, to make sure that not just the big parties, but also the small companies can start new ideas and can start to invent something that can potentially change the world. Strengthen our position, make sure the hub function of infrastructure stays intact to have that main port. But also, very, very elementary, room for growth for data centers. Data centers are the buildings where everything happens. This is where all the servers are. This is where the data is stored. If you can't grow that, you can't grow the ecosystem. So if you run out of electricity, you run out of space, or you get into other problems, then suddenly this whole mainport ID can stall out very rapidly. So all of these factors have to be taken into account. I'll address a few. One is that we very, very often, you will probably recognize, is the common concept of what the internet is. This relates to digital skills. What is the internet? How do we explain that? We see the internet often by its effects, by the data that is delivered, by AI that's coming up, by e-commerce that's changing the world, by technologies that disrupt classical things. So we look very much on the surface at the societal impact. But if you look at what the internet is, then if you ask your typical neighbor, somebody who's not technically educated, they will say, okay, I connect to the internet. So how do you do that? I have a mobile phone or I have a fixed connector to connect me to the internet. And then there's the internet. So some magic happens somewhere. And if you ask people, where is the internet? And some will explain me sometimes, yes, it's in some place in Finland or in Ireland. That's where the internet is, because I've seen there are some big data centers. There's a lot of, a lot of lack of knowledge about what the internet really is. We started to educate very widely the general public, but also the politics and policymakers, what we think the internet really is, which is more a layered, structured approach. Digital infrastructures sitting there, the neutral, invisible, almost, facilities. The cables, the wires, the data centers, the storage clouds, the hosting facilities, the domain functions, and the whole structures that go along with that, such as the ICANN and the organizations that monitor that basic infrastructure that stays neutral. And then we have digital services, the companies who make their money out of the fact that they can now deliver technology and data using that infrastructure to their constituents, to society, to consumers, and to businesses. In the Netherlands alone, there are 60,000 of those companies. Because very often, if we think about digital services, we immediately jump to the big guys, to the Googles and Facebook. A lot of attention and focus is on the hyperscalers and on the large brands. But in fact, a good and healthy economic ecosystem comprises of many, many small companies, thousands, tens of thousands of companies that make their living out of the fact that they can use the internet to deliver. And then we have the digital society. What we call digital society could basically refer to, let's say, the society as we know it, that has now to deal with the internet because it changes their business, it changed their way of working, but also as the internet and these services as a factor that help them to stay relevant, to innovate, to become more efficient, to use AI, to use new technologies, to do what they always did, but then better, stronger, stay relevant, and deliver their value. And one of them, of course, is also government, very strong. Then we have, of course, the threats that we talk about. We see new developments, backdoors. We have threats. There was a report just a week ago by the Dutch government saying, we're looking at a risk of disruption at society. This is not small thing, so something we need to address. And then there's still the misconceptions, I don't know about security and I like to keep it that way. It's also something that that we address with our stakeholders. I come to some of the programs that we work together to round. Many programs that we closely cooperate with the government, and that is something that is really good in the Netherlands. We have close lines, has been mentioned before several times. Different programs, Nederland Digitaal, NLDG Better for what the government, the cybersecurity agenda, and as we feel as a private sector, the responsibility to participate, to cooperate, to strengthen these programs and to use our knowledge to create that common goal of a safe place to do business in digital mainport. Three programs that I briefly want to mention to round this off. One is a private initiative called the National Scrubbing Center. Just a small initiative by some companies that decided, well, we can't do it alone, so we should work together on protecting ourselves against DDoS. Because if you don't, if you're a small company, it's expensive. The scrubbing center now protects 42% of the total Dutch digital economy against DDoS. And it's a very small facility, just a bunch of people who created a backbone on the Amsterdam Internet Exchange, put together lots of technology, and effectively now protecting already for 3 years many DDoS attacks daily. Nobody notices. The sites continue to grow, and DDoS is more becoming now an exception than the rule. So we effectively mitigated that by cooperating. Second one is an abuse platform that we put together for managing vulnerabilities and to take away badness from hosting networks. A code of conduct, a reporting facility, research done by TU Delft, very close cooperation with the Ministry of Economic Affairs and ECP to get that done. A very successful program that's now rapidly gaining. And the third one is a program called Partnering Trust. And Partnering Trust is an initiative to secure, to make security, and also very closely related to the Cybersecurity Act in Europe, to make sure that complex value chains of different actors in the digital economy can trust each other's data and can trust on each other's security without very difficult contracts and complaints, something which makes compliance under the GDPR in terms of security easier, but also something that will make it much easier for stakeholders to recognize if an entire service, including all its components, is secure. This is some of the examples, and I want to round this off by another tile wisdom, like we do this in Netherlands, to say, it's basically an African proverb. It says, well, if you want to go fast, you go alone, and that's how you see how big companies sometimes operate. But if you want to go further, you have to go together. And that's the only way. There is no single party that can solve the problems around cybercrime, around security, around mitigating the risk alone. It's not the government with just law. It's not the private companies who have no incentives. And the combination of corporations, sticks and carrots, and facilities is strongly something we believe in that will create and hold our digital mainport as a number one hub, but also creates examples, sets examples for cooperating on externalities and things that we don't want in the internet. So this is where I round it off, and I'll hand it back over to Ari.
Okay. Give him a big hand. Michiel, stay there. Our next keynote speaker will be here shortly, so we have some time to maybe take questions, or otherwise I have questions, mm-hmm. because you have a huge amount of information and your enthusiasm. I know you really doing this work and bringing parties together. The Netherlands, the way up there. My first question would be, if you look at all those, you mentioned three, but we have a lot of programs, projects with different stakeholders. How come it works? I mentioned also some characteristics of working together in the Netherlands, but what's your experience? How do you really get results?
Well, the classical way of private-public partnerships we found didn't really work in the digital age. And this is because, let's say, to replicate the multi-stakeholder, you need the neutral ground. So we worked together with ECP, with ARI. We found that's basically the only hub in the Netherlands where you have that neutral ground. Because if you go to a big company, they have the tendency to dominate the agenda. If you have small companies, you still have to find a common place. If you go just to government, you end up with discussions. Government is, of course, tied by legal. Government has to adhere to the law. So to have that neutral ground to find, let's say, uncovered and undiscovered ground to deal with this new idea, you need to neutral place. So that's one thing. And the other thing is you don't just want to talk, you need to act. So all these programs also need concrete money. They need goals. And these are not just projects. Security is not something that is done when the project is done. Now we're safe, we can all go home. This is something that will continuously need to be enforced and amplified and improved by organizations.
And you mentioned money, but the one who pays, does he dominate, or how do we do this?
No. It's absolutely crucial that all the sport, and this is still a maturity step that I see also in many other countries. Who will contribute to let's say, the functions and the things that you need to keep the internet safe and to improve on all these cooperative initiatives? And that's sometimes a challenge. And all these parties need to contribute. Companies, larger companies, government, nobody needs to dominate those discussions. So this is a challenge, I think, and also a very interesting topic, how to finance search, how to finance reporting points, how to finance hotlines, how to finance these functions that we all need to keep the internet better and safe.
Thank you. Is there somebody in the room who wants to question, to make a question to Michiel about the Dutch infrastructure and all the arrangements surrounding it? Who will dare, or who has a comment? I can give somebody, yeah, please. I will come to you.
There are mics in the audience.
There, oh yeah, there's a mic also here, but this time I will come to. Please, who are you?
Hi, I'm Dushita from InHope, a network of internet hotlines where people can report child sexual abuse material. And I fully agree with you because we work with governments and nonprofits and industry. My question to you will be, how do you deal with information sharing? Data exchange is something that we find quite challenging because governments collect one type of data, NGOs another, industry a third, and when we come together, it's very difficult to combine all of it, whereas the combination is the success. So that's my comment.
Good question.
Absolutely. We feel that sharing of information around threats, vulnerabilities, is crucial to keep the internet safe. And on one end, we see different pools of information from hotlines and shadow surfer and all sorts of points that have crucial bits of information. On the other hand, we see that networks to connect that and to make sure that the information is being directed to the right actor, companies like Econis, such a hosting company, who needs that information to know what's going on in the network, or an ISP who needs to know what consumers, what vulnerabilities or what cybercrime activities in the network exist. So that's a crucial thing and still being developed. I see that struggle also in many countries, in Germany, in France, to put together networks where that information can be shared. That's one thing. And the other thing is that we see some new legislation coming up that makes that increasingly difficult. So GDPR sometimes prevents information sharing because there are IP addresses involved, and even e-privacy is going to make that potentially more difficult. So I share that concern. I share the need to share information, but also share the concern that we need to deal, act together as governments and industry to make sure that with all good intention of new legislation, we don't throw away capabilities that we also need to keep the internet secure.
Thank you very much. Give a big hand to, I have to stop now here, this part. Michiel is available all the conference for questions or for working together. I want to go to our next keynote speaker. Thank you very much, Michiel.